From BYU Broadcasting's performance studio, this is Highway 89. I'm Stephen Cap Perry. Imagine for a moment that it's 1974. That year, Hank Aaron will hit his historic 714th home run. Richard Nixon will resign the presidency in the wake of the Watergate scandal. Lucille Ball will broadcast her final appearance after 23 consecutive years on television. And McDonald's will open its first restaurant in the UK. But you're not in the baseball stadium or watching television or eating a hamburger. You're sitting in an audience in Johannesburg, South Africa, ready to listen to a performance of Beethoven's Piano Concerto No. 1. The pianist performing is Anton Nel, and he's 12 years old. Well, he's our guest today, all these years later. We'll find out how he did in that concert. That long-ago performance was just the beginning of a musical education that would take Dr. Nel from Johannesburg to Cincinnati and a performing career that to date has spanned four decades. He's played the most prestigious venues in the world, Carnegie Hall, Lincoln Center, the Library of Congress, to name just a few of the American venues where audiences have enjoyed his performances, as well as halls in Canada, England, France, Holland, Japan, Korea, and, of course, South Africa. Dr. Nel joins us today live in the studio here on Highway 89. Thanks to him for coming to share an hour of music and conversation with us, and our thanks to the Gina Bockauer International Piano Foundation for arranging this visit. We'll have plenty of conversation during the hour, but let's begin with a little Handel. Here's Air and Variations from Handel's Suite No. 5, the movement popularly known as The Harmonious Blacksmith, performed by Anton Nel, live on Highway 89.
Thank you.
Dr. Anton Nel, performing live in Studio 6, handles air and variations from Suite Number 5. Beautifully played.
Thank you.
Maybe you could help us clear up the mystery of why this is called The Harmonious Blacksmith. We've heard everything from the ringing of an anvil to somebody, a blacksmith, whistling the tune that Handel liked. What do you think?
I've heard those too. I wish I had an explanation, but you know, it's probably one of these things that somebody just coined, like like Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata or things like that. I don't think, you know, it might have even been a publisher who thought that he could make extra money by publishing these variations as a separate thing with a fancy title versus saying air with variations. That's very possible.
That was the most boring of the possibilities that we found, which maybe means it's the true.
Well, it was, you know, there might have been money involved in it somewhere, yes.
Well, I did set up that we had to ask you, when you were 12, when you were 13, performing your first concert, how did that go?
Oh, you know, I think it went rather well. You know, at that time, I had only really been taking lessons for a couple of years, and I was a late starter. I was I grew up on a farm in South Africa, and I had wonderful, you know, teachers from the beginning. And at that time in one's life, you know, you sort of do as your teacher tells you. So I didn't find any of that so remarkable. But what I do remember was how much I did enjoy playing the instrument. And to this day, of course, I still do. That was always an enormous pleasure for me, was to play it.
We read a quote that said, by the time I was 13, I knew I wanted to make music my life. You did know that early.
You know, it was just something that I loved. And ever since all of that started to fall into place, I should add that as a youngster living in South Africa during those years, they were unbelievable opportunities for young people. And so by the time I came to the States when I was 20, I'd already had so much experience. You know, I'd been touring with orchestras, playing. I used to have some radio and television shows. And there was just tremendous experience and also tremendous guidance from my teachers. And so it just, there really wasn't another option. I enjoyed school, but this was really what I was interested in.
You've chosen some beautiful pieces. I'm so excited to get to sit by you here and hear and see them and hear them performed live. How do you go about putting together a program and putting together various pieces to make a concert?
As pianists, we're always, we're always the proverbial kids in the candy stores because we have so much wonderful music. Mm. And normally, I mean, I put together a program unless there's a certain request, that there's a theme that runs through it or a certain composer is being celebrated or so on. What I normally do is I just put together music that I think would go nicely together and that people would enjoy. Today's program for you, it's bits of the program I'm playing, you know, later this week. Or by the time this program is broadcast, I will have played. but basically, it's, I look for things that have different textures, come from different countries. You know, some tell stories, some are more absolute. It's basically stuff that I love. Something more unusual now and then.
Well, we're very excited to hear what you have prepared. And often we hear from Sweet Bergamask, we'll hear Claire de Lune, of course. But you're going to play all four of the movements here. Tell me what you love about what Debussy did with this piece.
Well, Debussy is just one of my absolute favorite composers. And I, unlike a lot of people, did not play Claire de Lune as a teenager. I learned this piece this year. This is the first season I've been playing it. And I think it is wonderful. It's something that evolved over time. He worked on it for many years before it actually saw the light, but it's one of his early works. And it harkens back to earlier times. The Claire de Lune actually initially was called the Promenade Sentimentale. It had another title, but it has a prelude and then a minuet, which is, these are old-fashioned titles, and then this beautiful Claire de Lune, and then the passepied, which of course is a kind of dance, which we see in much earlier works. You know, Bach, and even before, uses this kind of dance. But I love this. I love Debussy when he sort of is slightly neoclassical. Ravel did this too, of course, in Les Tombeaux du Couperin. So it's this kind of old music with a new twist.
Nice. Well, we are so pleased to hear all four movements from Suite Bergamask. As mentioned, the prelude, minuet, Claire de Lune, and passepied performed by Anton Nel. Anton Nel performing in Studio 6. We've heard him perform the entirety of Suite Bergamasque, Prelude, Menuet, Clair de Lune, and Passepied. I can't help but wonder, when Debussy was at the keyboard playing, for instance, the Clair de Lune, did he know he'd written a hit?
You know, I don't know about that. He was, I think he was a very complex person. That is always hard to say. I am sure... He was glad that he got played so much later on, but at that moment, you know, it's hard to say. He was so taken by all the French poets of the time, especially in Verlan and all these people, of course, and that's where the line comes from, from Clair de Lune, from one of the Verlan poems. And so, you know, all of this, it's so closely intertwined. I think he was just in his own world. Yes.
Maybe they'll like it. I like it.
Well, it's his most popular thing, of course.
Growing up in Johannesburg, but you earned your graduate degree here in the U.S. in Cincinnati. You've performed all over the world. 2003, you became a U.S. citizen.
I did.
Tell me about that journey, really going all around the world and then picking a place to stay and call home a new place.
Yes. Well, as I said earlier, I had so many, you know, great opportunities in South Africa to do things as a child until I was 20, and I decided... A lot of people, a lot of my colleagues, contemporaries at the time, came overseas to study further. And so it was, you know, it seemed to be the most natural thing for me to do. And so I went to graduate school at the University of Cincinnati, where I studied with Belashiki, who was a wonderful Hungarian teacher. And I also studied for a year with Frank Weinstock, who, of course, lives here in Salt Lake City, who's still a good friend. And at that particular time, I liked America well enough that I wanted at least to stay there for a little while longer. And the situation then was so different from what it is now. I had always been interested in teaching, and literally it was one of these things where I just decided that I was going to take a chance and apply for a college position. And the very first application I put in the mail went to the University of Texas at Austin, and it was my first job. It was just, that doesn't happen. That is just absolutely sheer luck. No, truly. And, and then subsequently, of course, there were other, competition successes and things. And gradually, this combination career was built over many, many years. And and I actually, I was a little bit reluctant to give up my South African citizenship. And it was just one of those things. But, even though I had a green card and, all the proper, documents, of course, to be in the United States, I still needed visas to go everywhere. And it was getting, I think what finally did it was just the tiresomeness of it all. Actually going to the French consulate in Houston once and the very stern and forbidding lady behind the glass recognizing me and saying, "Oh, hi, are you playing a concert?" I realized that it was time for me just to get my American passport.
Well, introduce us to this piece by Schumann. I've looked forward to hear the Faschingsschwank aus Wien.
Well done. Oh, it's a wonderful piece. It's from the late 1830s. It was still when he was in his absolute phase of writing only piano music. And actually, what it translates as is Carnival Jest from Vienna. And he actually had spent a very sort of productive sojourn in Vienna, where he saw and heard a lot of things, but didn't put roots down there like a lot of his forefathers, like Schubert and Beethoven and so on. Didn't. But he came back, and one of the pieces that came from there was this particular piece. It's not like his more popular pieces like The Carnival or The Seeds of Childhood, which actually tell a story. This is more of an absolute music kind of thing. It's like a suite or a sonata. And the first movement, which I'm going to play today, is just a big rondo. It has this sort of rollicking theme that comes back five times throughout the piece with little episodes. And it's very fun and very charming and very contrasting, as with him. He had these sort of two sides to his personality. There's a very funny tongue-in-cheek reference to the Marseillaise at one point in the piece, and that is really a little bit of a jab because it was forbidden to be played at that particular time. So in Vienna, so it's kind of fun, and then it has other sort of more essence of Schumann kind of movements: a romance, a scherzino, and an intermezzo, which is wonderfully passionate, and a finale. The two outer movements are very extensive, actually. I'm just going to play the first movement today.
We'll hear Dr. Anton Nel performing this work by Schumann. We'll hear, as he said, the first movement, the Allegro.
Thank you.
beautiful performance by Dr. Anton Nel, our guest in studio today on Highway 89, Faschingsfunk aus Wien, the first movement, the Allegro by Robert Schumann. I'm letting you catch your breath here for a second.
Oh, I'm all right. That's Thank you. It's so much fun to do, though.
Well, you get so much exercise, I'm sure, just practicing these pieces as you wipe your brow.
You know, the great pity about playing the piano is you do it sitting down. So even after a concert when one hopes that one might lose a few pounds, unfortunately, no.
Is there a thing that you can't teach that a student has to have to get the clarity of playing that you have? Is there just some basic understanding that I seem to be able to tell the difference between the different notes that you're playing and that you're choosing very consciously the melody or some other thing over another note?
You know, I think like in everything in music, there is a definite sense of hierarchy. And when you play anything, there is always, unless the composer specifically says so, something is more important than the other. And it's, you know, it's textural. On the piano, it's hard to achieve. I mean, you have to be technically very adept, but also your ears have to be attuned at every moment.
It's brilliant to hear it done well. It's just a kind of breathtaking to me.
Thank you.
Will you introduce us to this Waldstein, this piano sonata in C major? You're actually well known as an excellent interpreter of Beethoven. We've been hearing all these other composers, but I'm glad we get to dip into this well just a bit.
Well, yes, I adore the music of Beethoven. By teacher, I am related. My teacher in South Africa was a wonderful man called Adolf Hallis, who was, and I'll make this very brief, but he was almost 80 when I went to study with him. But he actually studied for many years in Vienna with a man called Theodor Leschetizky, who was a student of Liszt. Hmm. And Liszt was a student of Czerny, who was a student of Beethoven. So it's not so far back.
Just a short genealogy.
So I'm in that line, which makes me enormously proud, of course. But I relate very much to this kind of music. I adore it. I don't know what's... With Mozart, I feel the same, though. I mean, it's these composers that are able to say so much with not many notes, as it were. But the Waldstein Sonata, of which I'll play the first movement now, is something... The name comes from Count Ferdinand von Waldstein, who was a patron of Beethoven's student, sometimes friend, not always. Beethoven was a tough one to be friends with. But Beethoven gave him this wonderful present in 1801. And it's one of his greatest piano sonatas. What amazes me about the movement, especially that you're about to hear, is that, it happens with so little. It's got a repeated notes in it, a few broken chords, a trill, a chorale. And, you know, he puts that all together and stirs and out comes, you know, it's like a gourmet meal with three ingredients. Allegro con brio is the first movement.
Wonderful. We're going to hear this performed by Dr. Anton Nel, our guest today on Highway 89. Thank you.
Thank you.
Music by Ludwig von Beethoven, a performance by our guest today, Dr. Anton Nel, from the Sonata in C Major, Opus 53, Waldstein. We heard the opening movement, Allegro con Brio. I was missing a roar of applause after that beautiful performance, but of course you out there are listening, and I know you're applauding along with that beautiful performance. What a pleasure to have Dr. Anton Nel as our guest today in studio for Highway 89. I know you've enjoyed the music, conversation, and our special thanks goes to the Gina Bockauer International Piano Foundation and Joanne Rowland for arranging Dr. Nell's visit. Dr. Nel, of course, has a catalog of recordings that represent his solo work and his collaborations with other musicians. Find those recordings wherever fine recordings are sold, including digital outlets like iTunes and www.antonnel.com. That's N-E-L. If you just caught part of the show and would like to hear the beginning or listen again and share it with a friend, you can do that. All of our shows are archived online for free on-demand listening at byuradio.org/highway89 and follow us on Twitter at BYUH for live show updates and special behind-the-scenes photos and video clips. Highway 89 is a production of BYU Broadcasting in Provo, Utah. Our recording engineer is Mark Waite. Our student assistants are Abby Vance and Victoria Hardy. And the show's producer is Sam Payne. I'm Stephen Cap Perry. Thanks for listening.